If you're new, again, just for the sake of the other campuses, my name is Jeremy. I'm the lead pastor here, and I want to welcome those watching online as well as Arcade and Olean. We're in this series called One Step Away, which we started last week. And really, the premise of this series is I really believe that some of us are just one step away from realizing God's best for our life, one step away from living the life that God has for us. But a lot of times we don't take the opportunities to take that step. We're just one step, but what we realize is when we hold out on God and don't take that step of faith, we end up missing out on all that God has for us. And we talked about dumping the distractions last week, which hopefully you did. And one of the ways that we did that was through challenging our church and all of our campuses for 21 days of prayer and fasting. Not 21 straight days necessarily, but it's been encouraging to hear people choose certain sections of that 21 days, you know, a few days here, 7 days I've heard. One family is actually fasting from going out to eat. It was actually initiated by a teenager who told their family, "We're not going out to eat anymore." I don't think the dad was involved in the conversation, but they just made a decision that we're just not going to go out to eat. To different restaurants, we're going to eat at the table. So they still ate, but they had a really great designated time to pray together as a family and to study a chapter of the Bible. It's been great. I've heard another person fast from Xbox for 21 days, which for them was a big deal, and they used that time to dump the distractions and draw closer to Jesus, because that's really what we're trying to do in this series, identify what it is that we need to get rid of so that we can take that next step of faith in our relationship with God. There you go. And so today I want to look at this question that you'll see on the screen. And that is, what does it mean to be a follower of Jesus? As we take steps in our journey with God, as we take steps to draw closer to Jesus, what does it even mean? I mean, when people say the word Christian, that's kind of a loaded word in our culture. What does that mean? You just believe in God? Is that what it means to be a Christian, or is it something deeper? And really, when I use the term Christian, I'm talking about being a Christ follower. What does it mean to follow Jesus? And I think if we did a poll or a survey at all of our locations today, I think we'd have some good answers, and I think we'd probably have some not so good answers. I think some of the not so good answers would actually highlight the fact of the problem within our culture, that for many people, following Jesus is really out of convenience, not out of conviction. That when it's convenient, we're fans of Jesus, you know? Jesus is great. Like, we're a fan in the stand. When things are going well in our life, we clap for Jesus, and we sing for Jesus, and we get excited about Jesus, and sure, we'll read our Bible for Jesus, and then things don't go so well. And when it's not convenient, we don't have that same enthusiasm. We have this DNA, our core value is somewhere. We are followers, not fans. We believe that we should be followers, not necessarily fans who are excited for Jesus when things go well. Is your relationship with Jesus based out of convenience, or is it based out of a sense of deep conviction that Jesus Christ is your Lord? You just excited about Jesus because he saved you, or are you excited about Jesus because he's Lord, he's master? That's what I want to look at today. Are you following out of convenience, or are you following out a deep sense of conviction? What does it mean to follow Jesus? We just sang that song at all of our locations. I've decided to follow Jesus. Do you know the backstory behind that song? Some of you do. It's actually great when you appreciate some of the backstory and inspiration behind some of the songs that we sing. Well, the reason why that song was written and created was because there was a man named Assam who became a Christian in northern India. His whole family became a Christian in this Hindu village, and it was a capital offense to become a Christian, to convert to Christianity in that region. And so what they did to make an example out of Assam was to drag him and his family before the entire village and one by one execute them. Kill him. And later on, the story is told that Assam, this husband and father, was told, "Renounce Jesus, or I'll kill your kids." And he said the words that we just sang. "I've decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back." And the kids were killed. After the kids were killed, he said these words: "The world behind me, but the cross is still before me." When he said those words, they killed his wife. His children, his wife are gone, and he says these words: "Though no one is here to go with me, still I will follow Jesus." Doesn't sound like convenience, does it, right? It sounds to me like this was a man who had deep conviction that even though someone would take his family, take his whole existence, they could not take away his soul. They could not take away their soul, that there is an eternity that lasts and is so sweeter than this world. We need to answer the question, what does it mean to follow Jesus? And we need to get a little bit more serious than our culture is about what it means to follow Jesus. And so I want to walk us through a section of a chapter in Mark, the Gospel of Mark. It's page 844 on your pew Bible, if you want to follow along, or you can just follow along on the screen. It's just as easy. I'm going to start reading at verse 27. Here's what Mark chapter 8, verse 27 says. And this is, keep in mind, this is Jesus walking with his disciples, teaching his disciples what it means to really follow him. And he says this, and Jesus went up with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And I just want to stop right there. Caesarea Philippi in this story is actually an important detail. I think a lot of times we read scripture and actually just skim on by some of this important stuff. But this location was really important because it was almost like Jesus taking them on a show and tell. Because Caesarea Philippi was an area that had a lot of altars to pagan gods. In other words, the backdrop of this story and the lesson that Jesus is going to teach is he's going to show them a location, an area that the world had a lot to offer. And the reality is, when we look at our world, the world has a lot to offer that will lead to nowhere. The world has a lot to offer, but those things that it offers often leads to nowhere. And this is the backdrop in which Jesus tells this story, in the backdrop of Caesarea Philippi, which has so much of the world, so much of these pagan gods. He says, this is what it means to follow me. It says, on the way he asked his disciples, who do people say I am? It's a good question. He wants to know what the world thinks about him. What does the world say about me? Who does the world say that I am? And as in today's culture, there's a lot of confusion about Jesus. And in their culture, they believed in reincarnation. And so they get some weird answers. And they say, well, some say John the Baptist. Others are saying Elijah or one of the other prophets, which they were dead. It could be them, you know. So they just come up with all these weird answers. And it highlights and it emphasizes the fact that our world is very confused. Nothing's changed in 2,000 years. Our world is very confused about who Jesus was. And then he flips the question, and he asks the question that really is the most important question. That no matter what the world believes, what do you believe? He says, what do you believe about me? Who do you say that I am? And Peter, the guy who, if you've read some of the New Testament, he's always the first one to go, right? I'll walk on water, you know, and he goes. He's always the first to answer, and Peter says, you're the Christ. He got the right answer. He just didn't understand the question. Like he said Christ, but he had a whole different idea of who Jesus was going to be. And it shows by what is said next. Jesus says, don't tell anybody. And then in verse 31 says, and he began to teach them, Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things. Peter's thinking, no, you're the Christ. You're the king. You're going to be the guy who overthrows Rome. You're going to make everything that's wrong right. You're going to fix it now. Don't you want Jesus to fix everything now in your life? You know, we have different ideas of what we think Jesus should be in our life. Peter did too. He thought Jesus should just fix everything now. You should be the king now. And Jesus' answer is, no, I'm going to suffer and I'm going to die. I'm going to suffer and I'm going to die. I'm going to handle it differently. He says, and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed. And after 3 days, rise again. He said this plainly. Like he just told them exactly what I just said. It was very plain, no gray area. He's going to die. And 3 days later, he's going to rise again. And Peter, I just find this funny. Peter didn't really like that answer. So Peter does like, you know, come here, Jesus. We got to talk. I don't think you understand, right? Trying to correct Jesus. And it says he began to rebuke him. The key word that I circled in my Bible is the word began. Like it didn't last long. You try to rebuke Peter or Jesus, it doesn't last long. In fact, Jesus flips it and he says this, but turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter. And he says these words, get behind me, Satan. Never a good thing when Jesus calls you Satan. You're just not in a good position. He says, for you are not setting your mind on things of God. This is important. You're not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of who? Convenience or conviction? Are you following just out of convenience, or is it out of a deep sense of conviction? And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he's kind of like, you know, come here, I'm gonna teach you something. He said to them, if anyone would come after me, and just stop right there. If you look at this slide, I kind of left it blank after the comma intentionally. Because I think the reality is we all have different perspectives about God, and depending on where you are in this journey with God and how long you've walked with him and whether you're not a Christian, you'll fill in the blank with your own perspective about how Jesus should interact with you based off of your interaction with him. In other words, he'll say, come follow me. And you might say, well, if I follow you, everything will be great. Everything will be honky-dory. It'll all be roses and rainbows. I will never have any trouble in this world. In fact, you may have gotten baptized and thought that all of your problems will be solved because of your step of obedience and baptism. And then you realize that it just sometimes gets worse. Because the more we draw closer to Jesus, the more our enemy comes up against us. And so we all have our own perspective about what life should be when we love Jesus. But he says these words, if anyone would come after me, go ahead. Let him deny himself, and take up his cross, and follow me. 2,000 years removed from Jesus saying this, a lot of us, you know, we wear necklaces with the cross on them. We adore the cross. We love the cross. We sing songs about the cross. In many respects, the cross is something to be revered. It's beautiful. But to them in that culture, it was anything but. The cross was actually a place of execution. It was a place of death. It was an instrument of torture. And so in our day and age, instead of the cross, you know, around your gold necklace, it might, I actually found a picture. They might make these. I don't know. It's an electric chair Jesus. That's what it would have been. Or a lethal injection Jesus. You can Google this. They might have these online. You might want to get one for yourself. But we use the cross, but not out of disrespect, but out of adoration, because we know that to take up our cross is not really necessarily to say that everything's going to work out great for you. It's to say that even if it doesn't work out great for you, even if it's not convenient, I'm still going to follow because of a deep sense of conviction to know that Jesus is my Lord, right? And so he says, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. That's what it really means. And he says, for whoever would save his life would lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world? What does it do you any good to get everything that the world has to offer, but forfeit your soul? In verse 37, I love this question. For what can a man give in return for his soul? What can a man give? What can a woman give? What could a child give in return for his soul? Let me ask you a different question. What would you give in return for your soul? And the answer is everything. Anything. Which isn't that the point? Even when it's not convenient, you're still going to follow. Even when things aren't going out great, you're still going to follow. Anybody have a bad week this week? And you say, yeah, you're still going to follow, right? You're still here? Still going to follow. No turning back, no turning back. No matter what the enemy comes up against you with, God is stronger. You'll eventually get through it because he's greater, and you're still going to follow him. You would give anything. And then in verse 38, it says, for whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. You know, one of the things I love about our church, all of our campuses are like this. I just think it's neat. We're a church where we have different people along the path. We are a church where if you look around and you know people's stories, everybody's at different points along the journey. I love that. I love that our church is multi-generational, that we have babies to people who are 80, 90 years old, still serving, still actively involved in ministry. I love that. I love the fact that we have a church where our young people are not just seen as kind of like over here, but they're actively serving. Practically, our whole children's ministry, our media thing is run by kids. They're involved, they're engaged, They're being a participant in their faith. I love that we have a church that sees young people as they're never too young to become who God created them to be. When my son Aiden was baptized, I think it was like 2011, he was 7 years old. And I was really hesitant about baptizing him that young. I want him to remember it. B, I wanted to understand it. And so for about a year and a half, maybe 2 years, he kept bugging me, you know, about getting baptized. And kind of, you got to understand the difficulty here. The Bible says, believe and be baptized. My son's wanting to get baptized and obey the Bible. And I'm kind of like, just wait. So I wanted him to understand it. And so I said, if you read through the Bible, let's read through it together. I gave him a little Bible. He's reading through it, just showing that he understands it, showing that he's loving Jesus, wants to be committed. And so at 7 years old, what's the answer? You're never too young to become who God created you to be and to take that next step of obedience, right? I love the fact that our church, you're never too old to become what you might have been. I love that we have people who, you know, I think of a story, a guy who was 45 years old, turned his life around, didn't go to church before that, started coming to church, and now is heavily involved in our church. I love that we have people who are 50 and 60 years old who walked away from the church for years and are back involved in church and ministry and serving, hosting small groups. I love that about our church. You know what I love? I love about our church that you can come into our church, come on Sunday mornings and have no background in Bible or church experience. Maybe didn't even ever come to church before. You can feel welcome and not confused within our church service. I love that you can come to the church service and not know where the book of Ezekiel is or what page Jeremiah is in the Old Testament and still make it in our church. You know what I mean? I love about our church that you guys are so welcoming, that you say, come as you are, but I love you enough that you're not going to leave here the same. We're going to challenge you. We're going to push you to know Jesus and obey him more, because we believe that when you take that next step of faith, you're going to have the best life that you can ever imagine. Because following Jesus is better than following this world. And, you know, I find interesting when you look at this story, Matthew 8, when you go over to Luke's account, his record that he gives in Luke chapter 9, it's the same story, but he adds one word. Look what it says. He said to all, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross. We just heard that, right? But he says, daily and follow me. That each and every one of us is in this journey with Jesus. We're all on different points of the path. And it's your decision and my decision whether we're going to become stagnant and complacent in our walk with Jesus, or each and every day, no matter you're 7 years old or 6 years old, you're going to take that next step of faith and obey him with and trust him with what he's calling you to do, to take up your cross and follow him. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to identify where you're at on this journey, because we all got different paths. We all got different paths and paths. We all got different shame and sin and baggage that we're carrying. I just want you to identify where you're at and what your next step might be. One of the things that has helped me, and I don't mean to make this sound all cute and easy, but one thing that's helped me identify that in my life is one thing that Rick Warren calls the path to discipleship. He uses concentric circles. Rick Warren wrote The Purpose-Driven Life and The Purpose-Driven Church. And he's got five circles, and they go in, and you know what a concentric circle is. I don't need to go on about this, do I? It's a circle. You want me to explain this to you, Aaron? It's a circle, and then another circle. And the inner circle is where you want to be. You start off on the outside circle, but you want to be in the inner circle, which is the core. So you go from the crowd or the community to the core. And I couldn't find a good picture about that, so we're in this series called One Step Away. I thought I'd use feet, all right? So we're going to use feet. I'm going to explain this to you. You'll see on this thing here, the screen, five steps, and maybe you'd identify with one of these five. And again, I don't mean to make this sound like cute and easy. It's just helpful to me, that's all. And they all start with the letter C, but maybe you start at the crowd. And the crowd is really coming and seeing. It's just come and see, which is what I love about our church. Everybody and anybody's welcome. Just come and check it out. You know, it's interesting when you look at the disciples. Mark chapter 8 is not when Jesus meets these guys and said, hey, take up your cross and die, you know? That wasn't the opener of his conversation. He sees Peter, who's a fisherman, who's not catching any fish one day, and he fills his boat with fish. That'll get your attention, right, if you're a fisherman? Not catching anything all day, and then all of a sudden you got a boatload of fish, and he says the words, come follow me. What do you think Peter did? He got out of the boat and followed Jesus. You would too. And then there's this guy named Nathaniel, and they were trying to get him to come check out Jesus. And all they said to Nathaniel was, come and see. I think that's a good philosophy of ministry when it comes to Sunday morning at church. In fact, that's the starting point. You kind of want to know what we're doing here on Sunday. If you're a believer and you've been a believer for 40, 50 years, that's great. Keep coming. Keep singing about Jesus. You'll grow deeper, I guarantee it. And you'll glorify God with the worship songs that we sing. That's great. But ultimately, you're here to make an investment out there to bring people in here so that they can ultimately discover a relationship with Jesus, which is why oftentimes we'll preach the gospel, the same gospel that you probably heard for 50 years, that you're a sinner in need of a savior, that sin separates you from Jesus, and if you repent and believe in Jesus, he'll make a way for you to be right with God the Father. Amen, right? And half of you guys just check out. I heard that before. Well, pray during that moment that someone who hasn't heard it, who hasn't accepted it, who doesn't understand it and committed to it, that they would know that. It's one of the reasons why our church exists on Sunday morning, that people would feel welcome to come and see. Just come check it out. That's how Jesus started with his disciples. Then don't just stop there. I mean, it might take you a few weeks to come check out and feel comfortable with the church, but ultimately we want you to be a part of the congregation, which is to come and join us. Come and join us. I use the Taylor as an example. Tim, our worship and ministry coordinator here at our Wellsville campus, he I don't know why you did this, but you checked out 6 other churches before coming to join us, right? 6 other churches. I thought it was the first one, then you kind of wandered away for 6 weeks and you eventually came back, but he came, and it took him a little bit of time to visit some churches. And he was already a committed Christian, but it took him some time just to feel comfortable with the church family. But ultimately, at the end of the day, if you're visiting and coming and seeing and inviting your friends to come and see, ultimately we want you to find a church home that you can call family, that you can start to get to know one another. And even though Tim was a Christian, ultimately what we want you to do is to step across that line of faith to become not someone who's just checking out church and knowing about God mentally, but you're actually a Christ follower and that you have a church home. We want that for people. But I mean, some of you, that's where you're at. You know Jesus is your Savior. You got a church home. You come most Sundays. That's it. And that's not a bad spot to start. But that ain't the end point. Let's keep going. Then we got the committed. I would say committed are people who are committed to growing. Come and grow. We want you to come and grow. We don't want you to just come and sit in a pew. We want you to get involved, maybe a Bible study, a small group, certainly the Bible. You know what my spiritual growth strategy was when I became a Christian at the age of 16? The guy who led me to Christ gave me a Bible and said, read the Bible. That was it. Where do I start? Just read the Bible. So here's what I did. I found out later on there's a better strategy for reading the Bible than this, but I just opened up to page 1. Because that's what you do when you read a book. You open up to page 1. Who opens up to page 100? You just start at the beginning. And so I started reading through Genesis, and I'd have basketball practice at 6 o'clock that night. School got out at 2:30. I went over to my mentor's room, my earth science teacher's room. That's who he was. He also taught physics, which is, I got another funny story about that. But I just started reading, and I learned about guys who lived like 900 years old, and I kind of had some questions about that. And so I'd write down some questions, and I'd get to Leviticus. I had some questions about that, and I got to Deuteronomy. I got all these books, and I'm like, I don't understand. And that's okay. So I started where I was at. I asked some questions, and I started to grow. And I got into the New Testament, read about Jesus, and then all of a sudden, some of the Old Testament started to make more sense. And I read it again, and I read it again. And that was my spiritual growth strategy. Pretty simple. But it starts when I was committed in a relationship with Jesus. I wanted to know more about him. And then I started getting involved in other Bible studies. And Christian, I had 2 Christian friends my senior year. We just started meeting and growing in community. That's where I thought that was best for me to grow. And I think that's what God gives us as opportunities, to get in together with other believers and to grow in our faith. We provided for you guys at all of our locations a small group brochure that looks like this. If you didn't get one, there's a small group table at each of our locations out in the foyers. It gives you opportunities. Remember what I said last week? We're going to give you plenty of opportunities to grow. This next year, take every opportunity that you possibly can, and I'm well aware that not everybody can do this every season of their life, but take the opportunities that are put before you and engage in them. And if after a year you haven't grown spiritually, Go to another church and try it out. We want you to grow spiritually. If it's not here, go somewhere else and grow. But this is a good opportunity for you to connect with other believers, build friendships with them, and study the Bible. Start to grow in your faith. We got Mondays and Tuesdays and Wednesdays and Thursdays and Fridays and Saturdays. It's going to be hard for you not to find something that might work for you. There's topical studies, there's sermon-based studies. There's all kinds of stuff. Just look it over. There's a sign-up form here if you would like. If you have any questions, go to the small group table. But prayerfully consider how you can be involved. I think it's a good thing. If it doesn't work for you this semester, consider next semester. Don't beat yourself. It's not a guilt trip. It's just an opportunity to grow in your relationship with God. Be committed, though. Whatever it is, be committed to grow in your faith. Get into the Bible. 21 days of prayer and fasting. Do whatever it takes to dump the distractions and be committed to grow. And then from there, I would say come and serve. You know, it's great. Here's what I learned. Here's my journey as a Christian. I read 3 hours at a time in the Bible when I first became a Christian. It was like me, you know, it was like a little toddler eating all that food, you know, and doing nothing. Just, you know, pooping in my diaper afterwards. Just eat, and nothing for anybody else, and boom, boom, boom. And I wasn't doing anything to help anybody else with the gifts that God has given me. And that's just early on in your walk with God. You got to mature beyond that at some point. A great illustration that God gives us is the Dead Sea. Geographically speaking, the Dead Sea is the lowest sea level elevation in the world, I believe. And the Dead Sea, there's a reason why it's called the Dead Sea. There's a reason why it's so depressed in elevation. And that's because it's got an inflow but no outflow. Did you know that? It's one of the most salt concentrated bodies of water. You can literally just float in there. If you sink in any other body of water, you can just go in there and float. There's nothing that's alive in there. It's a dead sea because it's got no outflow. And I think that's the way a lot of Christians are. They get to this point, and it's all about me, 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 me. But we never take the gifts and the talents and the experiences and the opportunities to bless other people. I encourage you. Certainly, you can serve out in the community. I think that's very, very important. And there's opportunities to serve in the church as well, through nursery and children's ministry and youth ministry and hosting a small group and being a part of the worship team and helping with your hands. Guys, if you're good with construction, there's plenty of opportunities here at the church to get involved. I'm just saying, if you're not serving anywhere, consider serving somewhere. If you're not serving anytime, anywhere, consider serving once a month on a rotational basis. We have plenty of opportunities. Let us know. On the back of your connection card, there's actually spots where you're interested in serving. We'll get a hold of you. If it's once a month, up it. Go every week. Be involved. Grow. That would be a key part of your discipleship path. And then finally, commissioned, which is essentially coming and dying. Coming and dying. Which is what Mark said. His gospel said, to take up your cross and to follow me. It's laying down your wants, your wishes, your desires. And you know what the ironic thing about this is? Everybody, if you're a Christ follower, is called to this. It's where your life no longer is about you, it's about God. It's what he wants to do in your life. It's not just about receiving God's light, it's about being the light of the world, where you're wanting to tell other people about Jesus. Someone wise once told me, how do you know if a person, a Christian, is mature or not? And I think it was like at VBS time at a previous church, we were walking down the hallway. I said, I don't know. He said, you can tell whether a Christian is fully mature or not the same way you can tell whether or not an adolescent or a young person is fully mature. They're able to reproduce themselves. Doesn't mean that they're mature mentally, but physically, if you are able to reproduce yourself, you're physically maturing. You're mature. In the same way, as a Christian, if you're able to reproduce yourself, if you're able to share your experience of what Jesus has done in your life and lead someone else to Christ and help them grow, that's where we need to go. We're commissioned to go and tell the world about Jesus. And it starts with the people around us. So all I'm trying to say is identify where you're at on this journey with Jesus, because we're all at different points in the journey. And that wasn't meant to say, like, you stink if you're over here. It's just like we recognize the fact that we're all in this together. We're all in this journey process. Find where you're at and just commit as a Christian to take that next step. Go from being only when it's convenient to being committed. To being committed. To being where it's out of a sense of conviction. Go from it being, next slide, guys, from consumer to contributor, where it's all about intake for you, where it goes to outflow to other people, where it's participating to, instead of just being a spectator, being participating in your faith. And then go from being Jesus, just seeing him as your Savior, to your Lord. It's not just a get out of hell free card. It's actually Jesus has authority over your life because of what he's done for you. He's your Lord. Where are you at? Take your next step. That's what the series is all about. And I think it would be wrong of me to just kind of jump ahead into step 4 or 5 without dealing with the first couple steps. In fact, last week when we gave the invitation for people to receive Christ as their Lord and Savior, guess what happened? 4 people responded. 4 people accepted Christ as Lord. Isn't that awesome? That's awesome. I think it's awesome. Some of you think that's awesome, but they're just beginning. What's their next step? What's their next step? And perhaps it's the same next step that some of you need to take as well, even if you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior a while ago. It's what Luke talks about in Acts chapter 2. Look, what this is the early church. This is what happened. It says, so those who received his word were what? Help me out. Those who received his word were? They were baptized. It's a big deal. It says, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. If you read, if you kind of do a study through the New Testament, there's 27 instances of someone being water baptized. If you just kind of read through the New Testament, 27 examples of someone going down into the water and coming up out of the water. And every single example, they were baptized after they made the decision to follow Christ, not before. Like if you were a guy and you went to a jewelry store and you were looking for a ring and the lady behind the counter said, oh, you getting married? And you said, no, not really. They would look at you like you're crazy. Why would you put something on like a ring before you made that commitment? A decision for baptism is always after a decision to follow Christ, if that makes sense. And so while we dedicate babies, we baptize believers. There's a spot for dedication of children and babies, but really baptism is about you making that profession of faith. So here's the deal. Next week, next Sunday, we're having baptisms at all of our locations, and it's going to be awesome. We already have people signed up for it, but I think we need even more, because if that's the next step that you need to take, then I'd encourage you to take it for 3 reasons. I'm going to give you 3 reasons why you should get baptized, and if you've already been baptized, don't check out. I'm going to give you 3 reasons why you were baptized, to appreciate it, to fully understand that. Here's the first one. This won't take long. Just bear with me. The first example is to follow the example of Christ. It's a pretty good reason, right? If no other reason whatsoever, that's a pretty good reason to do baptism, to get baptized, to follow the example of Christ. I use the illustration of a wedding ring. A wedding ring is an outward sign of an inward commitment. This doesn't make me married. It just represents my commitment that I belong to someone else. Baptism is a symbol that we put on as Christians that represents that we belong to someone else, that Jesus Christ is our Lord. It's a symbol. Think about that. We're told to follow the example of Christ. He was baptized. Did you know that? He was baptized. You say, well, why was Jesus baptized? Isn't baptism like a symbol of our sins being washed away? He didn't sin, so why did he need to get baptized? It tells you something about his viewpoint of how important baptism is. If it was important enough for Jesus to do it, he tells us to follow the example. He tells us to do the same. Paul says it this way. The Apostle Paul says, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. If you want a life verse, whether you've been baptized or not, if you don't get anything out of this sermon other than this, that would be a good life verse to have. Whatever you see Jesus do, be committed to doing as a Christian. If it's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for you. Follow the example of Christ. Here's another reason, to demonstrate newness of life. I don't know if you know this, baptisms back in the day, you know, they didn't always have like hot tub water. You know, back behind the screen at all of our locations, we got like heated water. It's actually really nice. unless someone forgets to turn on the heater, which has happened a couple times. But other than that, it's really nice warm water, pretty clean, except for the occasional fly that's, you know, just floating in there. But we scoop that up before you even get in. No one knows about it. We just scoop it up and get it out of there. But we have clean water. Some churches have like filtered water, like really clean industrial filtered water. Back in the day, they didn't have that. You know where they baptized people? It was in the Jordan River. Muddy, muddy river, if you've ever seen pictures of that. Really muddy, disgusting, dirty river that they would get in. They would be dipped down under the water. They would come up out of the water. And tradition tells us they did this cool thing. I think maybe we should start doing this too. They had two garments that they put on. The first garment was a clean, nice-looking garment that was white, really nice. And then the second garment they would put on top of that first garment, and it would be torn, it would be ragged, it would be dirty. And so when they went down into the water and came up out of the water, they would throw off that old torn ragged garment and reveal the new garment underneath. And the old garment that they tore off, they would actually let it float down the river to say that was my old life. It's actually what Paul talks about. He says to put on the new self created to be like Jesus and to take off the old self. That's what we're doing in baptism. That's a great picture. We're taking off the old, saying bye-bye, floating down the river. That's not who I am anymore. I'm not going to be perfect going forward, but I'm definitely not that person. Jesus has changed me. That's a beautiful picture of what baptism is. Look what Paul says in Romans 6. He's describing baptism. He says, do you not know that all of us have been baptized into Christ Jesus? We're baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death. What does that mean? Buried with him? I'll tell you. In order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, that when you go down underneath the water, you're being buried with Christ in baptism, that you believe that Jesus died for you, was buried in 3 days. What did he do? He rose again. So we rise again. So we believe that. That's what Jesus said. But we're also declaring that with our lives, that we no longer want to live for ourselves. We're burying that with Jesus' death. And we want to live for a new way of life. And then look what he says. He ends it by saying, so that we too might walk in newness of life. Baptism is a picture that demonstrates your commitment to Jesus, but it also demonstrates how he's changed your life. So we follow the example. We demonstrate newness of life. And here's a third reason why I think you should get baptized. And that is to go public with your faith. You say, well, what's the big deal about baptism? I got communion, you know, I do communion. I just don't want to get in front of people and get wet and have to talk and do all that stuff. What's the big deal? It doesn't save you. I've said that all the time. Baptism doesn't save you. Just because you don't get baptized doesn't mean that you don't get into heaven. Just the same way, unless I took my ring off, doesn't mean that I'm not married, right? I'm still married, ladies. You need to know that. I'm still married, but I put it on. Makes sense for me to put it on because it shows my commitment to my wife. So what's the big deal? Some people say that, you know, my faith is so private, I don't want to do that. Let me encourage you with a couple thoughts. Baptism, while it doesn't save you, it is very, very clear in the Bible that it's a step of obedience. Just think about that journey with Jesus. He's going to ask you to take multiple steps, to trust him, to obey him. That very first step that he asks you to take is to believe and be baptized. It is a step of obedience. It's not a strong suggestion. He tells us to go into the world and baptize people, to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It's kind of an important deal. It's a sacrament. It's a sacrament that survived hundreds, thousands of years that we still do in the church. And then for those of you that say, well, my faith is private, you know, it's one of the reasons why there's a lot of people in our culture that don't want to go to church. It's kind of a private thing. And I think what you mean is that your faith is personal. I hope that's what you mean. And I would agree with you. Your faith is very personal between you and God. But nowhere in the Bible does it say that your faith is a private matter. It actually says the complete opposite. Your faith, while it's personal, it is not private. It'd kind of be like, you know, like before I go to work out into the world from my house, I do one of these, you know. Aaron might have a little problem with that, right? Like I get, you know, like I got a little shelf in my garage, and before I get into the car, I just kind of be like, and get in the car and drive off and just kind of live however I want to live. Aaron might have a little problem with that, right? And well, she should, right? Not putting on the symbol of baptism is kind of like that. It's that outward symbol to say, I belong to Jesus and I want to live for him. And so that's why we do it publicly. It is to show people an outward sign of that inward commitment that we've made that I want to, I got to put that back on. Sorry. Can't forget that. Some of you have done that and have been in the doghouse before. But it's going public with him, okay? Matthew 10 says, so everyone who acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. So what do? You just take your next step. And if you haven't been baptized before, I'm praying, I'm fasting that our church would add a renewal to understand that they really need to take this step in faith and baptism. I pray that next Sunday at all of our locations, it is going to be one of those Sundays that will be remembered in the history of our church. It's going to be amazing. It's going to be awesome. And if you are feeling like that's something that you need to do, my encouragement would be this. Follow the example of Christ. It's really clear. It's very simple. Follow his example. Demonstrate the difference that he's made in your life. And go public with your faith through baptism. Just do it. In fact, everybody of all of our locations, if you could do me a favor, on the back side of your connection card, you guys can pull that out now. If that's something that God is leading you to do, check the next step that says, I'm interested in learning more about baptism. One of the campus pastors will follow up with you this week, and you'll be all set to get baptized next Sunday, January 22nd.
Now, what about being baptized again a second time?
I'll answer that after the service, Daniel. But for the rest of us, we need to ask ourselves this question. How seriously am I following Jesus? Is it out of convenience or is it out of conviction? Only you can ask that. But my prayer is that the more and more you commit, join us, come see us, join us, be committed, serve, be totally devoted to him, die to yourself and live for him, you'll experience more of what God wants for your life. Whatever that next step is, take it. I want to invite the worship teams to come forward at all of our locations, and let's close in prayer. We're going to worship. Father, thank you so much for your patience with us, first and foremost, Lord. I pray that as we struggle to follow you and make that right decision day after day, you're so patient with us. You're so gracious to us. I think about my own story. It took me 10 years to make that decision to follow you through baptism. And we all have our excuses, and we all have our doubts, and we all have our thoughts and stuff. And at the end of the day, it's got to be as simple as we follow you, Lord. You're going to set the example, and we're going to follow that. And I pray that that would be our life verse, that as we move and act and call us to a deeper relationship with the Lord Jesus, I pray that we would take those steps. God, I pray that you would be glorified in this moment now as we worship you through song. And may your name be lifted high. And it's in Jesus' name we ask this. Amen. Yeah.